Welcome back. We'll look at the chapter on atoms from class 12th physics. So we'll look at the solutions for the exercises in the textbook. 12.1, choose the correct alternatives. Question A. The size of the atom in Thomson's model is dash the atomic size in Rutherford's model. So in both the models, whether it's the Thomson's model or the Rutherford's model, the atomic size is the same. So the answer is it's no different in either of the models. Question B. In the ground state of dash, electrons are in stable equilibrium, while in dash, electrons always experience a net force. So in the Thomson's model, or the plum pudding model, you have the electrons always in the ground state, and they are in equilibrium. Whereas in the Rutherford's model, electrons always experience a net force. Question C. A classic atom based on dash is doomed to collapse. So a classical atom based on the Rutherford's model is doomed to collapse, because Rutherford's theory could not give a satisfactory explanation of how the electron would stay in its orbit and not decay and fall into the nucleus. Question D. The positively charged part of the atom possesses most of the mass in dash. So the positively charged part of the atom in both Thomson as well as Rutherford's model is based in the nucleus. Hence, both of them have the most mass in the positively charged part of the atom. Question 12.2. Suppose you are given a chance to repeat the alpha particle scattering experiment using a thin sheet of solid hydrogen in place of gold foil. Hydrogen is a solid at temperatures below 14 Kelvin. What results do you expect? For this, we should go back and recall that the experiment that Rutherford performed was with a thin sheet of gold foil, and gold has a heavy nucleus. It has an extremely heavy nucleus relative to the alpha particle that was shot at it. The alpha particle is the nucleus of a helium atom with two protons and two neutrons. But now we are replacing the gold foil with a thin sheet of solid hydrogen, which means the nucleus of the hydrogen atoms will be the new target, and they are comprised of just one proton and one neutron. They will be lighter than the alpha particles that are shot at them. Hence, one of the major observations that we'll make is that there will be no large angles of deflection observed for those alpha particles that hit the nucleus. Question 12.3. What is the shortest wavelength present in the Paschen series of spectral lines? So here you will recall that there are several series of lines that we studied in this chapter. The Lyman series, wherein jumps are from higher orbits to orbit number 1. The Balmer series, where the jumps are from the higher orbits to orbit number 2. And then you have the Paschen series, where the jumps are from higher orbits to orbit number 3, where n is equal to 3. So keeping that in mind, we also use the relationship hc by lambda equals capital R into 1 by n1 square minus 1 by n2 square. So here this value is the Rydberg constant, and h and c values are known to us. So for Paschen series, as I mentioned earlier, n1, which is the orbit to which the electron is jumping, that takes the value 3. And the question says, what is the shortest wavelength present? So for the shortest wavelength, an electron has to jump from the highest orbit possible, which is infinite. So n2 will take the value infinity. So substituting these values in the equation, we get hc by lambda equals 21.76 into 10 to the power of minus 19 whole multiplied by 1 minus 3 square minus 1 by infinity square. So simplifying this, we get the answer as 818.9 nanometers. Question 12.4. A difference of 2.3 electron volts separates two energy levels in an atom. What is the frequency of radiation emitted when the electron makes a transition from the upper level to the lower level? So here, the question provides us the difference in the energy levels between two orbits, and the question asks us to find the frequency of the radiation that's emitted when an electron jumps from the upper level to the lower level. So first, let's take the energy and convert it into joules. So 2.3 electron volts multiplied by the charge on an electron gives us 3.68 into 10 to the power of minus 19 joules. Now, we know that frequency and energy, the relationship between them is E equals H into nu. So, H is Planck's constant, nu is the frequency, and capital E stands for energy. So we can calculate the frequency by rearranging the equation as nu equals E by H. So plugging in the values, we get the answer as 5.6 into 10 power 14 hertz. The point to be noted here is that whenever you use this particular relationship, the energy is always expressed in joules and not in electron volts. So please take care about that particular point. Question 12.5. The ground state energy of hydrogen atom is minus 13.6 electron volts. What are the kinetic and potential energies of the electron in this state? So minus 13.6 electron volt is the energy associated with the Bohr's orbit, or the very first orbit of an atom. So the total energy of a hydrogen atom is the total kinetic energy it possesses plus the potential energy. Now the kinetic energy is equal to the negative of the total energy. So kinetic energy is minus times E, where E is the ground state energy of hydrogen atom. So it becomes 13.6 electron volts. But potential energy, is equal to the negative of 2 times of kinetic energy. Now this is something that might be new to some of you, but it's a logical extension given that the potential energy is the energy for the atom to stay stable plus the amount of energy stored because the electron is bound tightly to the nucleus. So it becomes minus 2 into 13.6 electron volts, which is minus 27.2 electron volts. Question 12.6. A hydrogen atom initially in the ground level absorbs a photon, which excites it to the n equals 4 level. Determine the wavelength and frequency of photon. So a photon is absorbed by an electron and the energy propels it to n equals 4 level. So they have asked us to calculate the wavelength and frequency of the photon. So for ground level orbit, that is n equals 1, the energy can be calculated for a Bohr's orbit as E1 equals minus 13.6 divided by N1 square, which is minus 13.6 electron volts itself. Now the atom is excited to level n equals 4. So for n equals 4, the associated energy will be minus 13.6 divided by 4 square. So which will be minus 13.6 divided by 16 electron volts. Now the difference between these two energy levels is exactly equal to the amount of energy absorbed from the photon. So E will be equal to E2 minus E1, which is minus 13.6 by 16 minus of minus 13.6 by 1. Which gives us 2.04 into 10 to the power of minus 18 joules. Now having got the energy that is absorbed from the photon, we can now calculate its wavelength and frequency. So we use the common relationship E equals hc by lambda, and that allows us to calculate the lambda value as 97 nanometers. Now having known wavelength, we can calculate the frequency using C is equal to nu into lambda. So nu is equal to C by lambda. So C being the speed of light divided by the lambda value we have got, which is 97 nanometers. So that gives us a frequency value of approximately 3.1 into 10 to the power of 15 hertz. Question 12.7. Using the Bohr's model, calculate the speed of the electron in a hydrogen atom in n equals 1, 2 and 3 levels and calculate the orbital period in each of these levels. So they've asked us to calculate the speed of the electron as it goes around the nucleus in the first 3 orbits and also calculate the time it takes for an electron to complete one revolution around the nucleus in the first, second and third orbit. So let's first focus on getting the speed of the electron in these 3 orbits. Now the speed of an electron is given by the relationship V1 equals E square by N1, where N1 stands for the orbit number, into 4 pi epsilon naught into h by 2 pi. Simplified, we get E square by 2 epsilon naught h, where E is the charge on an electron, epsilon naught is the permittivity of free space, and h is Planck's constant. So plugging in all the values and taking N1 as equal to 1, we get a value of 2.18 into 10 power 6 meters per second. Repeating the same for n is equal to 2, we get a value of 1.09 into 10 power 6 meters per second. And for n equals 3, we get a value 7.27 into 10 power 5 meters per second. So one thing that you'll observe here is as you go further and further away from the nucleus, as you go to higher orbits, the speed of the electron, you can observe it to be decreasing. Now continuing forward, we need to calculate the time it takes to complete a full revolution in each of these orbits. So again, we'll take the time it takes to complete an orbit as T. Now T is related to the orbit in terms of T is equal to 2 pi R by V, where R is the radius of the concerned orbit and V is the velocity in that orbit. Now R can be calculated by the relationship N1 square H square epsilon naught by pi me square, where m is the mass of electron. Now putting all these values in the equation, we get 2 pi into n1, which is 1 for the first orbit, into the Planck's constant squared multiplied by the permittivity of free space whole divided by the value of the velocity we got in the first orbit into pi into the mass of an electron multiplied by the charge of an electron squared. So simplifying that, we get the value as 1.527 into 10 power minus 16 seconds. Similarly, when we calculate for the second orbit and the third orbits, we get values as seen here. Question 12.8. The radius of the innermost electron orbit of a hydrogen atom is 5.3 into 10 power minus 11 meters. What are the radii of the second and third orbits? So here, instead of going through the whole calculation, we should recall that subsequent orbits have a radius that have a unique relationship with the ground orbit. So the radius of the innermost orbit or the Bohr's orbit is given to be 5.3 into 10 power minus 11 meters. For n equals 2, the radius of the second orbit is n square times the first orbit, so where n is equal to 2. So to calculate the radius of the second orbit, all I have to do is multiply the radius of the ground orbit with the square of the orbit number. So to calculate R2, I multiply 2 square, that's 4, with the radius of the ground orbit. So I get an answer 2.12 into 10 power minus 10 meters. Similarly, for n equals 3, I multiply 3 square, which is 9, with the radius of the ground orbit. I get a value 4.77 into 10 power minus 10 meters. Question 12.9. A 12.5 electron volt electron beam is used to bombard gaseous hydrogen at room temperature. What series of wavelengths will be emitted? So a couple of concepts here. One, at room temperature, hydrogen gas is assumed to be in ground state. So ground state energy level is minus 13.6 electron volts. So all the electrons in every gas state of hydrogen atom is assumed to be in the first orbit. Now the energy supplied through the electron beam is 12.5 electron volts. So let's calculate the difference. So the difference between the ground state energy level and the energy supplied is about minus 1.1 electron volts. So that leads us to conclude that the energy supplied is sufficient for electrons from the ground state to jump to the second orbit, which has an associated energy level of about minus 3.5 electron volts, or to the third orbit, which has an associated energy level of minus 1.5 electron volts. But it can't jump to the fourth level because the energy level associated there is minus 0.85 electron volts, which is higher than the difference that we have obtained here. So now, once they have performed these jumps to either orbit number 3 or orbit number 2, the electrons come back to the ground state in a couple of ways. One, an electron from the third orbit can come to the ground orbit by making a hop into the second orbit. So some of the hydrogen atoms will have electrons which are excited, and in the third orbit they'll jump to the second orbit, and possibly somewhat of them may eventually jump back to the ground orbit. So N3 to N2 or N2 to N1, N3 to N2 followed by N2 to N1, or if the electrons are only excited to the second level, then directly from N2 to N1. So this leads us into to get two lines, one in the Balmer series and one in the Lyman series. Now, some of the electrons that are excited from the ground state to the third orbit may have electrons again performing a similar jump from the third orbit directly to the first orbit, in which case we get one more Lyman series line. So now that we know the different jumps that can be performed, we can use the Rydberg formula to calculate the corresponding wavelengths. So if an electron is jumping from N3 to N2, then we use the Rydberg formula where we plug in N1 value as 2 and plug in N2 value as 3 to get a value of 656.33 nanometers. Similarly, for Lyman series, N1 value will be 1 and N2 will take values of 2 and 3 in two separate calculations, giving us 121.54 nanometers and 102.55 nanometers respectively. Question 12.1. In accordance with Bohr's model, find the quantum number that characterizes the Earth's revolution around the Sun in an orbit of radius 1.5 into 10 power 11 meters with the orbital speed 3 into 10 power 4 meters per second, given mass of Earth. Now, this is a fairly straightforward problem where we equate the angular momentum MVR with one of the postulates of Bohr, which is NH by 2 pi. So MVR equals NH by 2 pi, and we need to calculate the value of N. So we keep N on one side and take the remaining quantities to the other side to get MVR 2 pi by H. Plugging in the values, we get a value of N, which is 2.6 into 10 to the power of 74, which is an extremely large number, and that would be the quantum number associated with the Earth's revolution around the Sun.